Hello everyone, welcome to the next class on the testing of the hypothesis. We will continue with from the last lecture of the non-parametric test. In the series of the non-parametric testing, we will discuss right now as the crucial one is H test. Myself, Dr. Garg, working in the School of Mathematics, Thapar Institute, India. You are most welcome to contact me by either of my email IDs or through my website or through my YouTube channel for spreading the knowledge. So what we have discussed so far, the several testing of hypothesis. This is the sign test we covered in the first class. Wilcoxon, we already discussed about that. Right now we are here. So this, all the others non-parametric testing, we have already discussed, and you can find the link of these videos in the description of this. So it must necessary that before watching this video, you must watch the Mann-Whitney test, because it's similar to that of the Mann-Whitney test. It is also called as the U test, and this crucial Wallis test is also called as the H test. So what is the crucial Wallis test? So the crucial Wallis test or H test is the non-parametric test, and which is very valuable, and it plays an alternative to the one-way ANOVA test. We know that we have studied the one-way ANOVA in our previous lectures, and you can see that in our one-way ANOVA, what we studied is there is a one classification, and we have to analyze their impact, whether there is any significant impact on that. But you must remember that when you apply for the one-way ANOVA, the basic assumption about the normality, that is, the population must satisfy the normal distribution, and the equality of the variance must be satisfied. But what will happen if this normality test is used to test for the equality of the several population, and the basic fundamental assumption is the population is drawn from the normal distribution? But what will happen if this condition does not met? Then you are unable to apply for the ANOVA test. In an appropriate place of this ANOVA test, we will apply this H test. Also, you have remembered that ANOVA test is applicable only when there is at least how many samples? Yes, at least 3 samples must be drawn. The same thing for here. The crucial Wallis test is applicable only when there is at least 3 samples are there. When there is less than of the 3 samples, then you can apply this U test, Mann-Whitney test. Okay, so this, what are the basic assumptions that we are needed to apply the H test or crucial Wallis test? There are at least 3 independent samples you have to draw, and each sample must have at least 5 elements. So if either of the condition is not satisfied, then H test is not applicable. So for what purpose it is used? Why we studied this crucial Wallis test or H test? So this test is used to check the null hypothesis that whether the k, what is the k, is it must be greater than or equal to 3. The k samples you have drawn have identical distribution or not. That is the basic task, and it does not require the condition for the normality. In other words, how you write the null hypothesis is the k samples you have drawn are identically distributed. And what is the null hypothesis is the k samples are not identically distributed. In other words, in mathematically, how you define the H0? If k samples are identically distribution, it means you can write as mu1, mu2 and mu k. And what is the opposite of this is at least one of them. What is the meaning of the at least is? It can be like this way. It can be of this mu k. It can be like this, mu1 and mu2 both are same, but not equal to mu3, is equal to mu4, and so on up to the mu k. Or it can be like this way, this is not equal, this is not equal, while all others are equal. Or you can say all are not equal, mu1 is not equal to this, is not equal to mu k. So any one of them is happening in this alternative hypothesis. Now what are the extension is that the crucial Wallis is the extension of the Mann-Whitney test, and you know that this Mann-Whitney test is used when there is a 2 samples. So when there is more than 2 samples, then we will apply the crucial Wallis test. So what is the notation is there? So it must be at least three samples, and these dots are representing my number of the observations. So what I assumption is there are k samples must be there, and definitely k must be greater than or equal to 3. I call as n i's is the samples, elements in the sample. For example, in this case, how many, what is the n1 is, how many elements are there? 5. What is the n2 is, look at that, how many elements are there in 7, and so on. And I called as small n is the total number of the observation, so that is this plus this and so on. And I use the capital T i is the sum of the ranks. So what is the meaning of the rank? You have to rank the elements, all those elements, and then find the sum. What is the meaning of the rank is, you have to rank from the smallest one to the largest element. And if there is any tie between them, you have to take the average. So we will see in the example how we will rank the elements. So a simple four-step procedure we will explain you. First step is you have to define the H0 and H1. Step two, you have to rank all the observations. And once you define all the observation, you have to define the capital TI, sum of the ranks. Once you define this, then we will define the test statistics H, which is defined by this way. What is the N is the sample size. This is the sample size. We have calculated how you calculate N is N1 plus N2 and so on. Capital T is my sum of the observation and so on. Once you calculate this H, it follows the approximately chi-square distribution with the degree of freedom as K minus 1. What is the K is? Number of the samples. So same as that of the one-way ANOVA. We already see that the degree of freedom in the one-way ANOVA is calculated as a K minus 1 also. So you can write this as H follows chi-square distribution with the K minus 1 degree of freedom at alpha level of significance. Once we find this degree of freedom and this value of H, then we will find the tabulated value of the chi-square. And finally, we will make the decision as this is 0, this is the tabulated value. And we will check whether this H lies in the rejected H0 or accepted H0. So look at the example, we will explain you more clearly. So if value of H is greater than of the tabulated value, then we rejected H0, otherwise we fail to reject. And this is one most of the most important remark is it always be the right tail. So look at the example. So a company 20 are randomly divided into the three groups. So look at that, there are the three groups. It means the Mann-Whitney test is not applicable. So you have to apply the H test or the Kruschel-Wallis test. 10 each and are given the course of the management scale by the three different methods. So at the end of the trainings, the test scores are given here. So what is the, you have to define whether there is any methods are significant or not. So you have to firstly define the H0. What is the H0 according to the statement? The three methods are equally effective. So what is the H0 is? All the methods are equally effective. Mu A, mu B, mu C. What is the H1 is? You can easily define that. At least two of them are different. Or you say three methods are not equally effective. Now what is the step number two? You have to rank them. How you rank them? There are the several methods are there. So you can rank them. How you rank? You can rank either the method A increasing order, method B individually in the increasing order, method C, the value of the method C in the increasing order. Otherwise, you can combine them in the increasing order. Look at that. What is the smallest value in it? Find the smallest value. This 56. So I can write this as the 56. From which sample it takes? C. Look at that. 56 is come from the C. And this is the step to compute the rank. Now look at the second smallest number is. Can it be 61? Can it be 60? Yes. So the next number is 61. So I can write here as 61. It comes from 61. It comes from the B. After that, what is the smallest number is? Is it 64? Yes. So I can write here as 64 from the A. Similarly, you can write the all other values are there. So this upper sample are taken from the sample. Now once you are writing in the ascending order, then you have to take the rank. This is the smallest number, you have to take 1. This is the second smallest number, take 2. This is the third. This is the second, next, this is next, and so on. You will calculate up to here. But after that, you can see there is a tie between them. They are the same numbers. So whenever there is a tie, so the position of here is 9, this is the position of 10. So there are the two numbers, you take the average of them. So it comes to be 9.5. So here 9.5, 9.5. Then now up to here, this is the 10 position is there. Now this is 11. Now there is a tie between them. So how many numbers are there? 12, 13 and 14. So there are the three numbers. So take the average of this. Divided by 3. So it comes to be 13. So you can write here as 13, 13 and 13. Now look at for the next number. Now how many numbers are there? 11, 12, 13, 14. 12, 13, 14. Now it's come to be 15. But there are the two repetition. So it's a 15 and 16. So the repetition is average is 15.5, 15.5 and so on. Now this is my step number 2. Now you can define the N1. You can define the N2. You can define the N3. How many elements in the A? You can take it from this simply. Look at the given observation. How many elements in the A is? 10. How many elements in the B is again 10. How many elements in the C is again 10. So you can write here as my N1, N2 and N3 as this. So what is the N is? Total of them. So it is 30. Now you define the T1. What is the T1 is? Sum of the ranks of the first sample. First sample is my A. Okay. So what are the elements of the A? These are the elements of A. So rank is 3. So what is the T1 is 3 plus what are the rank of A is 6, A is 8, A is 11, A is 15.5 plus A is my 20, next A is 22, then 24, 25 and 26.5. Okay, this is my T1. Similarly, you can find the T2, sum of the ranks of the B method, C and C. This is the first method. You can find the value of this. Another method is, instead of writing in the ascending or descending order, you can or look at the what is the smallest number inside it. The smallest number is 56. Place the rank as a 1 here. This bracket represents for the rank. What is the next smallest number inside all those numbers is 61. Place the rank as a 2 here. What is the next smallest number is? What is the next smallest number is 64. Place the rank number 3. Instead of writing in the ascending descending, you can write directly from here. What is the next smallest number is 75. Take the rank as a 4. Next smallest number is 76. Take the rank as a 5. Next one is, what is the smallest number is 79 is a 6. Then is my 83. 7. Then the smallest number is 87. No, it's 85. It's 8. Now there is a tie between the 87 and 87. So 9 and 10. So take the average. It's a 9.5. It's a 9.5. And so on. So once you will complete all those entries, you will get this answer. Okay. Then how you find the N1? N1 is remain same. 10. N2 is my 10. Look at that 10 elements. So how you define the T1 is, in this method you have to look at for the A and so on. In this case you have to add them. 24 plus 3 plus this plus this plus this up to 25 is my T1. How you find that T2? That is the rank of the second is the 7 plus 28 plus 30 plus 2 plus 17 plus 21 and so on. This is my T2 and so on. So look at that. These are there. How you define the T1 from this? Look at that, 24, 3 plus 26.5 and so on. So this is my T1, T2 and T3. Now, step third is you have to define this. What is the n is? N is my 30. T1 is this, 3 and so on. You can substitute the value here. 12 divided by this. What is the T1? Look at that. T1 is my 161. N1 is my 10. So you can calculate this here. Now, step number 4. That's the conclusion. You have to find the degree of freedom. K minus 1. How many samples are there? 3. So degree of freedom is my 2. Okay. Now it's a chi-square distribution. So you have to find the chi-square distribution at the given level of significance for the 2 tail. How you find this value? So look at that. This is a chi-square distribution table. How you find that? You can write on the Google as a chi-square table. You can simply write the chi-square t-test table. The first link will appear. You can open them. Then look at the what is the degree of freedom is 2. And look at the degree of freedom is 2 here. And the level of significance is 0.05. So what is the value is 5.91. You can see that. So this is the tabulated value of the 5.91 here. So this is the, you can write up to 2 or up to the 3 decimal places. Now, what is the calculated value of the chi? 0.196. Where it lies? It lies here because it lies between 0. So it is may be accepted. So since the calculated value is less than of this, so we fail to reject H0. What is your H0? That is, this was your H0. That is, all the teaching methods are equal. All the teaching methods are equal. This is your H0 and it is accepted. So what you conclude that you can say that all the methods are do not differ significantly. Now let's do quickly move example second so it will clear more to you. So these are some tests are there. So how you define that? You have to start with the step 1, H0 and H1. So look at that. What is your H0? So the objective of the experiment is to test the hypothesis of no difference in the population distribution versus there is a difference in the population. So what is the H0? That there are the 4 samples and each sample consists of more than 5 elements or 5 elements. So the crucial Wallis test is applicable. So what is that? This you can say all the 4 samples are equal. Mu1, mu2, mu3 and mu4. And here is at least one of them differ. All the 4 teaching are equal or at least 2 of them differ. What is the step 2 is? You have to rank the elements. So these are the given observation. So the one method is you can write in the increasing or descending order. But there is no need of them. You can write here. What is the smallest number in this here? Look at the what is the smallest number is? 59. You can rank them as a 1. Look at the next smallest number in them is 59 is 62. Put them as a number 2. What is the next smallest number inside it is 62 and then 65. Look at the number 3rd. What is the next smallest number inside it is? Is there 69? It appears 1 here. It appears 1 more time. So it's appeared 2 times. It appears 2 times as here. So look at that 1, 2, 3. What is that? So it's a, no, it's a 67 also. So firstly, it's 1 time only. So it's a 4. Now 69, it appears 2 times. The position is 5 and 6. So take the average 5.5 here and 5.5 here. Then now 6 opposition are there. What is the next number is? Now 7th number is there. So look at that. What is the smallest number is? 72. So it's a 7 and so on. Okay. So once you will do that, you can find all these ranks are here. Now, once you are finding all the ranks, look at that. What is the N1? How many elements are there? 6. What is the N2? How many elements are there is? 7. What is the N3? How many elements are there? It's a 6. What is the N4? How many elements are there? 5. So what is the N? That is a total. Okay. So that is my 24. What is that E1? Sum of these ranks. These are the ranks. So how you define 3 plus 19 plus 8 plus 12.5 plus 15.5 plus 5.5. So you can get E1. Similarly for that E2, you can add these elements. Similarly for the T3, you can find this ranks and these are the ranks. So this is quite easy way. You can rank add them here instead of writing all in the ascending or descending order. So once you will add them, you will get 63.5 is the sum of this. 89 is here, this and this. Now this is step 2. Step 3 is you have to calculate the value of Z. Now you can substitute here. What is the N is? 24. So it is my 24 and 24 plus 1, 25. What is that T1? 63.5 and N1 is my 6. So this is my 63.5 square divided by 6. Plus, what is the N2 is? T2 is 89 and it's 7. So this is 89 square plus 7 and so on. You will calculate the values as here. Now the step number 4 is the conclusion. What is the degree of freedom is? DF. What is the meaning of the DF is? Degree of freedom. So what is the degree of freedom is? K minus 1. How many samples are there? 4. 4 minus 1 is 3. So you need the tabulated value of the chi square with a 3 degree of freedom, and level of significance is given to you. Let me check in the question. Yes, it's a 5%. So what is the value of the 3 degree of freedom? This is the 3, level of significance 5 is 7.81. So you can see, you can write here as value as 7.814. Now look at this value, it lies in which case? It lies here. So H0 is rejected. So what is the H0 is? All the teaching methods are same. So that is rejected. So it means the teaching methods are not same or entirely different. So this is a simple procedure you can apply to solve the Kruschel-Wallis test, or this is the analog to the one-way ANOVA. So always remember, student, this is the four-step rule. I can quickly recall that. What is the step one is? Define H0, H1. Step two is you can rank the elements. You can rank the elements. And then you have to find the TI's sum of the ranks, sample wise. You have to find the sum of the ranks of the ith sample. Once you define this, then step third is you have to find the value of the H. And then step four is you have to find the degree of freedom and find the value of the chi square with the K minus 1 degree of freedom. And finally make the conclusion. So this is a simple procedure of the H test, or called as the Kruschel-Wallis test. That is for the one-way ANOVA. This is a supplement of the one-way ANOVA in the non-parametric test. We will see in the next class, that is a Feidman F test, which is the analog of the two-way ANOVA. If you miss any of the previous video regarding the non-parametric test, you can click on this link. You will find all those ANOVA non-parametric tests are there. You can like the video and subscribe the channel and share with your friends if you like them. Till then, best of luck, students. Happy learning.